As we look ahead to 2024, we have formulated some predictions around the top trends set to shape the year ahead, which you might have heard a little bit more about in our previous episode of the podcast. And these trends are formulated from demographic changes, economic trends, technological transformations, and generational insights. And two of our top trends for 2024 include the trend real environment and the growth reckoning trend. So helping me today to unpack these two trends in particular is McCrindle's Director of Strategy, Grant Dusting. Hello, Grant. Welcome back to the podcast.
Hello, Ash. It's great to be back. Thank you for having me.
I'm excited to delve deeper into these two trends specifically. We know that as two of the people on the team who are really formulating a lot of these ideas and pulling together the research and communicating that there is so much to say about each trend. So we wanted to give a bit more airtime to some of the trends in particular and two that we're going to talk about today. But before we get to that, Grant, I wondered if you could just talk to our listeners a little bit about how we come to develop these trends, give them a little bit of context before we delve deeper into two of them in particular.
Yeah, thanks. Well, as you would know, being heavily involved in this process, we, people like yourself and me and Mark and others in our team, we get the privilege of being out and about a lot at conferences and events, speaking, on different social trends. And we also get to hear what are the pain points and what are the things being talked about within companies and organizations in boardrooms and executive teams and staff teams. So I think really for us, this our trends of the year formulation is the result of a big listening exercise that we do kind of all year round. And I know that other companies produce kind of similar, produce their own content around trends, and that might focus on workforce trends, or it might focus on consumer trends or tech trends. And there are all those things. But I think what we're trying to do at McCrindle is to pick mega trends that actually have a few layers to them. So each of the trends, each of the eight trends that we've picked out as our trends of 2024, we've observed here are some key themes and almost like sub trends within them. And then we've grouped them together and said, well, actually, here's a trend that tucks in, this, this, and this, which we're all observing. And these are things that we think are significantly shaping life and leadership in the year ahead. So that's a bit of the process, and it's a bit of a collaboration between, really led by Mark McCrindle, who obviously is, being the founder of our business. He spearheads a lot of our thinking and kind of futurism, but, being social researchers, again, it's that listening process and collaboration. And I think for us to whittle it down to what are the key things we feel are significant, that are happening, that are worth talking about. And here we are.
Yeah, it is a real culmination of, like you mentioned, a whole year basically, well, years, plural, but also in the last few months, especially putting our ear out for what people are talking about, scoping out popular reports from other organizations, as well as all of our research that we collect. So it is a real process. And it's great to reflect on that, because I guess we're just in it and do it. But it was great to hear you talk about it. I'm like, that is what we did. That is how these came about.
Right? I think all of us really enjoy that challenge and that opportunity. So yeah, lots of fun.
It is. And it was hard as well to narrow it down to just our top eight. And like you mentioned, I think quite in a wise way, there's a few almost in each trend, there are a few other like sub trends or things you could really hone in on. And that's why, again, as I mentioned earlier in the podcast, we wanted to give a bit more airtime and delve deeper into some of these trends, which is why we're now only in this episode focusing on two. And the first of those is real environment. So Grant, you were tasked in our virtual event a few weeks back to talk about this, to share about this. So I thought it only fair that I give you the platform to explain to our listeners what we mean by the trend which we've described or named as real environment.
Yeah, thanks. I love the opportunity of presenting and trying to take complex ideas and communicate them simply. I found it really hard in our trends event to communicate this trend, the real environment, in basically 5 minutes, because we were going through the different trends. So it's nice to be able to flesh that out a bit more in this episode. So firstly, by definition, what do we mean by the real environment? Because it's it's not necessarily a term we've come up with. Like if you do a quick Google, you will see that reference, but it's not actually widely used. So in a way, I think we are actually popularizing that term with, you know, selecting that naming. So the real environment we're borrowing from the term and the kind of the terminology in the real economy. So people who are, you know, working in finance or economics or accounting would be probably more familiar with that term, which kind of, it's the idea that in that sense, in the economy, that there are things that are quite abstract, very intangible. If we think about financial kind of instruments, like even shares in a company, you've got shares, but now increasingly you've got these things like options to buy or sell shares, and then these you know, other very complex things, which I studied corporate finance and really enjoyed it, but I, you know, some of our listeners might switch off if I went too deep in that. But basically there's a lot of things that have become quite abstract, which people buy and sell and trade and, you know, try to predict the price going up or down, but they're actually very intangible and very detached from the everyday goods and services that people are buying and selling. So that term real economy started being used to refer to, well, actually like actual products, actual services, things that are tangible. And so similarly, when we've used that term, the real environment, to denote environmental commitments and practices that move beyond abstractions and buzzwords to actually engaging everyday citizens in tangible ways and on issues that affect people's day-to-day. So in terms of what do we mean by real environment, that's effectively what we mean. So that's probably a good starting point just to say, and that was presented in our kind of trends of 2024 webinar as well.
Yeah, it's a great summary. And the other part of this, I guess, dissemination of these trends, I mean, we talked about it at our virtual event. We're talking about it in the media. We're talking about it on this podcast. We also have an infographic summary of these events, and it's quite a different infographic, I find, to some of our other ones because it's a bit more conceptual in its way. And again, we had that task of less stats. Yeah, which is different for us. And we did that last year as well. And it's I love it. It's shout out to all of our design team who bring these really weird like Word docs that we have where we're like, we want to communicate this and this, and there's comments everywhere. And they're like, okay, I've got to distill this and communicate it. So we have launched that. So that's available on our website for people. But even with, if I was to describe what that looks like, and you can again, give me an evaluation of how I go of this, I've got it in front of me. We've got a person standing at a window looking out at the clouds and the sky and the hills, like the real environment. And then you've got them kind of turned away from someone on the television in this place, which they're talking about terms like carbon neutral and net zero and ESG. And I guess it's that kind of desire for people to want to have impacts with their purchasing decisions and consumer habits, or just for governments or businesses, they want to see those tangible impacts about the environment, but there is that disconnect between some of that jargon at times, which is what we were trying to get through this infographic and this particular trend. So it's something I think many of us can relate to around that disconnect between wanting to have positive impacts, wanting to see positive impacts, but then kind of being bogged down by some of that that jargon. And yeah, anyway, and so it was.
Well, and yeah. I think that's a great. That is a helpful visual summary. So for people who might better engage that way, take a look at that. And as you alluded to, we're bringing in a few different threads with this trend, real environment. So the first being that over the last few years, we've seen increased global efforts to address climate change, or to recognise then to address climate change. And I think that's not happened overnight. That's been a very kind of long and gradual process that's been snowballing. But so, you know, we've been watching that, tracking that, and I think we feel we're at that point where it's a lot more mainstream now, these discussions about environmental sustainability and stewardship and how to do that well. So there's a lot more efforts now being done, including, you know, by governments, but also increasingly being driven by kind of the corporate world, particularly larger corporates. So that's one thread thing that's happening. Kind of alongside that, we're seeing an increase of what's people might know as greenwashing, where it's, you know, companies have recognized that it's cool to be environmentally sustainable now, and it's mm-hmm. it's trendy and it's good for business, and so there's more companies who are now kind of throwing out buzzwords and terms like, oh, we do this, or we're, you know, sustainable, eco-friendly, you know, pick your favorite buzzword. But it's one thing to talk the talk, but another thing to actually to implement things. And so talking the talk, I think we're at this point now in this whole climate discussion where people have, consumers and kind of everyday citizens are a bit more wary of people who are just talking the talk and kind of using the words that are supposedly the right ones to use, the right things to say. And so that's probably the second thread, is just that greenwashing, where things are being labeled as green or, you know, sustainable, but actually what does that mean? Are they? And, you know, some, there's examples from time to time of companies being exposed for actually you're saying this, but actually it's not, when you peel back the layers. As well as a thread of something else that we've talked about on the podcast before, I think in last season, is just the growing kind of the social mood that's growing, there's growing skepticism towards governments and large corporations just across the board. And this has come out in some of the data we've presented around trust in organizations and institutions. So that, the, you know, the greenwashing thing and the lower trust thing are very much linked. So that's happening. And then the probably the other key trend, the fourth or thread or kind of sub-trend within this is, and we've, again, we've talked about this on the podcast previously, that we've got good data to show that actually everyday citizens, they do largely care about the environment, and they do want to make a tangible difference with, to the extent that they can, as individuals, as consumers. So people are, you know, everyday people are wanting to make their own spending and consumption decisions count and to make a positive impact on the world around them, and that includes the environment. So that's a key thread to this as well. So we've kind of pulling together what we've observed there across those different things. The challenge for leaders in 2024 is, if you want to engage and bring people on that journey, you need to, buzzwords won't cut it. In fact, they never should have. But I think there's this growing skepticism there.
Yeah.
So how do you make that, if you're serious about, you know, environmental sustainability, how do you take those things from buzzwords to actual practices to embedding them as cultures in your organization? That is the key for leaders in 2024, because otherwise everyday citizens are going to switch off or disengage.
Yeah, I love that as well, that you included those implications there for leaders. And it's not easy, not an easy thing to do, to move beyond buzzwords. It's hard, and we want to recognize that for anyone listening who might be in that role, but it's definitely worthwhile and important, and something we've observed that people want and is going to be an increasingly important part of our lives and this trend in 2024. So great work, Grant, explaining that first one. Any other reflections there on anything leaders need to be keeping in mind with regards to moving beyond that, those buzzwords?
Well, I think there'll be different implications depending on who our listeners are. I think for people who are in leadership roles in large companies or even in governments, there's different implications for those people. I think it's when it's part of the challenge with this, and part of what we're trying to get at with the real environment, is it can be very challenging for the everyday citizen to hear timeframes talked about, like 2030 or 2050, for example, say net zero carbon emissions targets. Often those timelines are net, you know, by 2030, by 2050, even sometimes here by 2100, this is where we'll be. And it absolutely is the role of governments to be planning long term. I mean, if they're not doing it, who else is going to? So we do need them to take the lead. But again, there can be a bit of skepticism from the everyday citizen to go, well, it's easy to make promises that you're actually not going to be around to be accountable for, whether you're in government or even, you know, not on this earth at all if we're talking 2100 potentially. So there's that thing to keep in mind, that actually while those things might be important as long-term plans, it's very hard for the everyday person to engage with that. So that's probably one layer for people in those kind of leadership positions and roles. And I think the other one just is relevant for every organization and leader, is just to recognize, and we presented some of this data in our virtual event, that people do care about the environment, but they care about the environment that's tangible to them, their local neighborhood, their local waterways, their local flora and fauna. And it's important not to lose sight of that. It can be a bit of a disconnect when you're talking about things that the average person has no control over, like decarbonizing the energy grid. Like that's a very big topic and issue, but the everyday person throws up their hands and says, well, I can install solar panels on my rooftop, but what else can I do? And a lot of the cases, those decisions are influenced by kind of, faceless people, maybe even in countries, other countries. So the challenge is, well, how do you make things practical? And I think every leader can think about how they do that in their organization, from the little things. So there's probably a couple of different implications for leaders there.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks so much, Grant. The second trend we want to talk about in today's episode is the growth reckoning, a very dramatic named reckoning, trend. Yes. For a little bit of reckoning, I know.
Not wrecking, reckoning.
But tell us, Grant, how do you define this trend? How do you describe it to people? How did you describe it in the virtual event, or maybe in a more expanded version for our listeners today?
Expanded? That was...
Did. I was like, I don't know why that was... No.
It's great. I love it. So, yes, I can expand on this one. The growth reckoning. So what we're saying here is, what we're seeing for 2024 is a collective reevaluation of social values and priorities, particularly in relation to population growth. And hence, we're using that word growth, focusing on population growth, and the word reckoning, which, when you reckon with something, it's you wrestle with something, or you actually have to come to terms with the implications of decisions. So people who've followed our work, even for a short time, know that we spend a lot of time talking and looking at population data and demographic data. And we are, Australian-based social researchers, so a lot of our work does focus on Australia, but increasingly we're looking internationally as well. And a lot of, while there's some specific applications here for an Australian context and particular challenges, I think a lot of these, a lot of the aspects of this trend would be are applicable in other kind of Western liberal democracies as well, particularly that have followed a similar kind of political and economic model. So, just a couple of things that are feeding into this. Again, like, what are the threads that are feeding into this growth reckoning? Last year we've global population passed 8 billion people. So we're, continuing up and up and up. Australia's population in just before Australia Day passed 27 million people. We're adding, I think we're on track, and we were quoted in the media as saying we're on track to reach 28 million, so add the next million by, mid to late next year. So we're kind of adding a million people almost, one calendar year after the next. So, and that's really been on the back of record net overseas migration in an Australian context. So I know that's similar for some similar countries to Australia as well. So that's in a nutshell what we're getting at with the growth reckoning, and what that's about.
Yeah, it's a complex one, and I think we posted a little Instagram video for our 27 million day, and we make jokes from our presentations that we have cakes when we hit milestones, and it can seem very pro population growth, and we try not to take a stance either way, but we look at the facts and the figures and we want to be realistic and look at the nuance of the benefits that population growth and greater cultural diversity brings to a country like Australia and other places around the world, but then also the challenges, particularly around, for many people in the current climate, with economic conditions and rising cost of living and rising cost of housing and wait times and congestion. And here in Australia, sometimes we even talk about Sydney and its kind of record growth in previous times. And the phrase that we sometimes use is, when you become a victim of your own success, and the idea that if the population growth isn't planned for or accounted for, then you get these negative implications on a society and on individuals' lives. So we wanted to, I think, explore that nuance in this trend. And so I think, yeah, how you described it is great. And even the idea of the reckoning, where we have to, wrestle with that, I think is a helpful way to talk about this particular trend. Grant, how do you think this reckoning, this wrestling with this growth, the pros and the cons, how does this impact our understanding of, say, economic priorities? And what considerations do you think, and what considerations did come into this trend in terms of, being at the forefront of these discussions and what people will be coming to terms with in that kind of reckoning around population growth?
Yeah, and I think, again, we've picked these trends because we feel there's a few threads to them which are converging. So most of our listeners won't be in necessarily policymakers in departments of planning or housing, etc.
Shout out to all the policymakers, yes, though.
I know we do have a few, but we see you registering for our events and joining our mailing list. Mm. So that's great, and we hope that our resources are helpful. But we know that many people will be not necessarily in those roles. But this is relevant because we're hearing more of the symptoms of strong, sustained population growth, now focusing on the Australian context as an example. We're hearing more of these discussions playing out in the media, in public discussion, and it's almost like the things that have been bubbling away, it's like the voices are growing louder and more persistent on some of these topics. So that's why, and we're often getting asked to comment on, because there's specific trends, for example, housing and affordability. I feel like it's almost on a weekly or fortnightly basis, we're being asked to comment on some aspect of housing inaffordability and the emerging generations and the time it takes to get in the housing market and just all of that. And you provide some of that commentary usually, Ash, as well. So we've got that as a big talking point. Mm. And I know that's a very relevant one globally as well, just the challenge of the younger generations, Gen Zs and even the millennials or the Gen Ys, our peers who are in their, the older of them in their late 30s and into the early 40s, who some of them actually still attaining and buying a home is a huge challenge. And so there's that thread. There's the kind of the crisis, the more social aspect of the housing challenge when it comes to like crisis accommodation and just short-term rentals and just the challenge of people, finding a place, not even a nice place, but just a place to call their own. Mm-hmm. And I think that's, we're hearing more of that talked about, and there's other people who've put out, who publish data on that quite regularly. It feeds into discussions about infrastructure, whether it's kind of roads and public transport to kind of key service infrastructure like hospitals or schools. All of these things impacted by population growth. And we work with a lot of these organisations. We work with aged care providers. We work with schools providing research and advice to them. So we're hearing a lot about these issues, but actually a lot of it does stem back to strong, sustained population growth. And so as well as the social cohesion aspect. And I think, again, that's one that is hard to quantify in economic terms, and I think often we see, the lens we look through and policy decisions are made is often purely economic, and I think that often misses the social aspect of just the social cohesion, just how strong social cohesion is so important for human flourishing and for societies thriving and for people thriving, but just the challenges that come when you're just strong sustained population growth. Not that it's not possible to have social cohesion. In fact, there's many examples worldwide where that has happened, but that actually needs some intentional thought. And so those are a few of the threads. So listeners might actually be experiencing some of those symptoms depending on where their organization and their work context fits. But really, all of that's kind of converging into what we see as the importance of, you know, reckoning with this this reality of population growth, but it's actually impacting all of you. So whether you're understanding your local kind of the demographics of your local area, how that's changing, that can actually inform, that can be really helpful to inform business decisions and strategies.
Yeah, absolutely. And it was really interesting as well. I know that you shared some of these insights in your PowerPoint slides, which we don't have obviously with on the podcast, but even around some of the research we conducted of Australians and their attitudes towards population growth. And correct me if I'm wrong, but from memory, the research did show that the public mood in general is pretty supportive of migration in principle and recognise all those benefits. But then when we explored at another level, do you have any concerns about that? We did see, like you mentioned earlier, some of those talking points like livability and infrastructure, cost of living and that social fabric and community well-being. So it's complex. And again, like we've talked about today, there is nuance and there's a few different trends going on within the one trend. But this is one, like you said, that doesn't just impact people who have the power to make policy decisions, but it impacts many of us when we think about community and affordability and livability. And we were, like you mentioned, at lunchtime today talking about housing affordability, our group of Gen Z and millennials and where people are living and what their next move is and unaffordability and just the demand and every time you go to an open home, how many people you're competing with. And so all of that has a flow-on effect that I think many of us can relate to. So
yeah,
it's a tricky one.
I shared in our virtual event, which if listeners didn't know, you can actually access that on demand through our website, purchase access to that. So that is available if you're interested in taking a deeper look. But as was presented, what we're presenting here is actually we've got some data on the public mood. So it's really to understand that these are the felt concerns of the public and it's important to be good listeners. I use the reference the Stephen Covey or Covey quote that we like around here is, it's all about being, listen first and having that posture of listening and good leaders are good listeners. So, yeah, I mean, probably just the extra layer to add in terms of even going, peeling back further in Australian context is pre-COVID, the fastest growing state in state and capital city in Australia in kind of percentage terms was Melbourne. And I think Melbourne might have been fastest growing in kind of, what's the word, total, in total as well, total population. COVID changed that and Australian listeners would know that Melbourne had, some of the most severe lockdowns in the world, famously. So a lot of people fled for greener pastures, sunnier pastures, particularly up to Queensland or over to WA apparently. So for the last 3 years really, through 2020 to 2023, WA and Queensland have been the fastest growing states as a kind of, when you look at the percentage growth. And so those two states in particular, which are smaller than New South Wales and Victoria, the capital cities, Perth and Brisbane, are smaller than Sydney and Melbourne. You can pour people in, but there comes a reckoning. So I think there's specific applications for WA and Queensland in particular, who have had that strong population growth. And in fact, in the last 12 months, Perth, the fastest growing capital city in Australia in the most recent reporting period, and WA, the fastest growing state. So there'll be particular challenges, and that impacts obviously housing and those other things we've mentioned, infrastructure. So yeah, depending on where people are geographically, there might even be more specific. We talked about the rise of the regions and the challenge through COVID of like regional towns getting influxes of people and just the implications there. So there's many layers to this growth reckoning, but I think what we hope would be a takeaway for leaders is to consider the implications of decisions around population growth and migration. And I think as a society in Australia in particular, we are very much a strong migrant nation. I think that's something that I'm very proud of personally. And you know, my mum's family were migrants from Europe, and you know, according to the stats, you know, the majority of Australians either have migrated for first gen migrants or second gen migrants. So
yeah.
That yeah. very much is the backbone of Australian culture, beautiful, strong migration. But I think it's more about encouraging people to think through the implications and making sure that decisions are made with a wide-eyed or open-eyed kind of appreciation for, okay, if this is happening, what needs to happen to create strong community cohesion and infrastructure and all the rest. Those are some, I think, key takeaways that I would suggest.
Yeah, some very wise thoughts there at the end, Grant, and peppered throughout the whole episode. So thank you so much for all the work you've done in developing these trends, the eight of them, but also these two in particular, and for your time today on the podcast.
Oh, it's a lot of fun, and it's a real pleasure. So thank you, Ash.
And as you mentioned, Grant, if anyone would like to access the recording from our virtual event or the infographic summary, that's all available on our website. So we'd love for you to head to McCrindle.com to find that out. And just in general, if you'd like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can always subscribe to this podcast. You can follow us on social media or head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you for listening and bye for now.